Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to day five of our virtual refresher course on direct taxes. We would like to thank the Direct Taxes Committee for all the assistance that they have given in organizing such a program. Special thanks to the chairman and the vice chairman of the Direct Tax Committee of ICAI. We've had a 5 day sort of great learning on direct taxes. We're closing this refresher course on a high with a session by CA Palak Pavagadi from Ahmedabad. Palak sir is a founder of Pavagadi Shah and Associates, a CA firm based out of Ahmedabad. His expertise includes direct taxes, advisory and litigation on direct taxes and overseas investments. He also acts as a mentor to global financial services and consulting company that is engaged in BPO and KPO outsourcing services from USA, Canada, UK and Australia. Palak sir is an excellent academician and has secured a rank and gold medals in the CA exam. As well as his university exams. Over the years, he's been invited to join as a member on the board of various professional bodies. Palak sir has been appointed as a board committee member of the Global Business Roundtable. He's also worked as a member of the Corporate and Allied Law Committee of the ICAI and has suggested various changes to the Indian government in the process of framing allied laws. He's also worked as a member on the Financial Review and Restructuring Board of the ICAI for reviewing the balance sheets of various Indian listed companies. With these short words of introduction, may I request Palak sir to please start off with this presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, I'm very thankful to Direct Tax Committee, ICAI and Ernakulam branch for giving me this opportunity to share my views on a topic which is generally considered to be a dry topic. The pay package or salary we call, or the issues under the head income from other source merged with the clubbing. I'm thankful to the chairman, sir, Ranjit Warrior. I'm thankful to Alan Joseph. I'm thankful to CA Deepa Varghese for giving me this opportunity. And I'm thankful to all the participants, all the members. The subject proper. I divide my presentation into two. First, we will be discussing about salary and the pay package. And thereafter, I'll switch over to the issues related to the other source as well as the clubbing. If I start with the person salary, or I would say the pay package, whether the screen is visible.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah, fine. So this is related to the pay package. See, I may say that I have to deal with certain basic issues also, as well as the technical aspects also. So I'll try to balance my session into the basic issues as well as the technicalities. First portion, for the purpose of entering into the topic salary, that is section 15 to 17 are the sections which are covering the topic salary or pay package. To enter into the topic, the first and foremost requirement is there has to be a master-servant relationship, or there has to be an employer-employee relationship. Meaning thereby, the person getting the money, the person getting the remuneration must be an employee, must be working under some master. Then only this topic will be coming into play. The important issue here would be that this master-servant or employer-employee relationship is thoroughly different from the principal and agent relationship. I'll clarify. Assume that I am into the business of X article in Ahmedabad, in Gujarat, and I want to start the same business in Ernakulam. Now, if I am planning to start the same business in Ernakulam, I have decided to start my branch over there. And assume I have appointed Mr. X to run this branch as my branch manager. Now, if he's running my branch as branch manager, I'm going to make him certain payment, but he is supposed to follow the rules and regulations set up by the HO, set up by me. He is my employee. Whatever he's getting would be his salary income. Now, that may be a fixed amount, plus that may be some commission on the percentage of sales made by him, but that would be part and parcel of his salary. Against that, if I want to expand my business and if I give agency in Ernakulam to say Mr. Y, tell him that whatever you want, I would supply you. You make the sale and I'll be giving you simply the agency commission. And I am not supposed to give you any fixed amount. You can do the work at your comfort, at your convenience. You are not supposed to adhere to the rules which are designed by me for the employees. Then in that case, whatever that agent receives would be part and parcel of agency commission. That would not be termed as the salary income. So it is totally different than principal agent relationship. Now, if I go to certain technical issues related to this employer employee, the first issue comes up is, what about the public prosecutor or attorney general receiving from the government? Public prosecutor means the person who is filing the case on behalf of the government. Attorney general, same thing. Like we go to tribunal, we fight the case on behalf of the authorized representative. From the side of department, there is DR, there is departmental representative. Whatever this DR or public prosecutor or attorney general getting, would it be the salary income or not? And answer clearly is no, it is not salary income. Whatever the public prosecutor or the attorney general receives would be part and parcel of professional income, because they are not employee. They are not, there is a condition precedent that they cannot take the case from any private person. They have to take the case only of the government. But it is open for them to pick up the case or not to take the case. Say, for example, that if there was a case of Sanjay Dutt, which was filed by, if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Ujjwal Nikam, who was the public prosecutor. Now, if Mr. Ujjwal Nikam is given the case of, say, Salman Khan, he's not fighting from the side of Salman Khan or Sanjay Dutt. He's fighting from the side of government. And if Ujjwal Nikam doesn't want to take this case, then it is open for him to deny. If you are an employee, you cannot deny. So whatever the public prosecutor or attorney general receiving is considered to be their professional income and definitely not their pay, not their salary. Same way, director of the company. It depends. If director is full-time associated in the company, it would be their salary. Or if you are making the TDS under 194J, it would be their professional income. The question arises, what would be advisable? It depends. If you ask me, being a Gujarati, being an Ahmedabadi, I don't know what is the scenario at Kerala, at Ernakulam. I had been to Kerala, Ernakulam, twice or thrice, but it was only for the holidays purpose, because I would say one of the finest state, one of the most beautiful state in India I've ever seen. Not for professional purpose, so professionally I'm not much aware, but being a Gujarati, I would definitely say that we believe in saving the tax. We believe that wherever possible legally, we should try to save the tax of the client. Now, if the director is getting the salary, he would fall under section 15 to 17. If there is a TDS under 192, he would fall under section 15 to 17. If he falls under section 15 to 17, then in that very case, he would be having a very limited tax advantages. What planning you will make if you are getting salary? House rent allowance, or you can get education allowance, or you can get hostel allowance. We'll be discussing all this. Or you can have, earlier, 2 years, 3 years back, that 15,000 rupees medical work visit, or that 1,800 rupees conveyance allowance, were all the plannings which were permitted in the topic salary. But if you are taking director remuneration by getting the TDS done under section 194J and offering it to tax under the head business and profession, then sky is the limit for getting the expenditure deduct. You can get any expenditure under section 30 to 37 allowable, and That's where you will be at a benefit. Friends, I have a client who is getting the director remuneration from his company. He doesn't want to involve himself into any sort of controversies with the government. He says that I want to be very safe. Since years, my TDS is done under section 192, so I don't want to change the same from 192 to 194J, from TDS, from salary to professional charges, and I'm comfortable I will be making the payment of tax like anything. You are aware in 2019, our Honorable Finance Minister Ma'am has increased the rate of surcharge up to 50 lakh. There is no surcharge. 50 lakh to 1 crore for individual, the surcharge rate is 10%. 1 crore to 2 crore, 15. 2 to 5 crore, it is 25. And above 5 crore, you are aware, it is 37%. Now, my client, father and son duo, both are getting the remuneration from the company, which is almost equivalent to 6 crore rupee. From salary, if I make the planning, then also we'll see, I am able to make the planning of 6-8 lakh rupees. On a higher side, what more I would be able to make? So they would be ending up paying huge tax, not only huge tax, they would be ending up paying huge surcharge. If they pay 37% surcharge, their tax rate would be, members, nearly equivalent to 43-44% would be the tax rate. If I calculate here, 30% is the rate of tax, 37% is the surcharge, and 4% says 42.75%. is the rate of tax applicable to them. And I explained him like this. I said that, sir, your company is taxable at 22% and you are taxable at 42.75%. Either get the TDS done under section 194J so that I can get your car depreciation and your running and your other expenditure deductible. He said, what is the other planning? I said that the other planning would be to reduce your remuneration and take it below at least 5 crore so as to save that surcharge of 37%. He said that I don't want to do anything wrong. I don't want to change it from 192 to 194J. Let us reduce the remuneration. We reduce the remuneration. We reduce the remuneration to 4.5 crore. Unfortunately, friends, this client ended up selling a property in the similar year, an immobile property in the similar year, and he doesn't want to make any investment under 54EC or any other investment eligible for exemption under section 54. And due to that capital gain, his tax rate or his income went above 5 crore, sorry, and he ended up paying tax or surcharge at the rate of 37%. So I'm afraid, friends, if it is salary, it would be difficult for us to make the planning. But yes, within next 1.5 hours, we will be trying to make as much planning possible in the salary as we can. Third important issue is member of parliament or member of legislative assembly, whatever they are receiving, whether it would be salary or it would be professional income or it would be income from other source. Friends, Honorable Patna High Court, in the case of our ex-railway minister and ex-chief minister of Bihar, Lalu Prasad Yadav, has said that if you are MP or MLA, whatever you receive as an MP or MLA would be considered as part and parcel of your income from other source. Now, if it goes to other source under section 56, you are eligible to get all the expenditure deductible under section 57. 57 gives you depreciation, 57 gives you petrol, running, maintenance, driver and whatnot. But Honorable Patna High Court has also said that if you are MP MLA, it would be considered as other sources. If you are municipal councillor, it would be income from other sources. But if you are minister, including the prime minister and the chief minister, any minister, including prime minister and chief minister, whatever you receive would be part and parcel of your salary. Honorable finance minister, ma'am, Nirmala Sitaramanji, whatever she is receiving from the central government would be part and parcel of her salary income. But member of parliament from my constituency, if he is not minister or MLA from your constituency, if he is not minister, whatever he receives would be income from other source. There is a big difference. If it is income from other source, section 56 would be charging. Section 57 gives the deduction of many expenditure. If it is chargeable under section 17 bracket 1, that is salary, expenditure would be difficult to get deductible. Professors, full-time, part-time professors receiving from the college would be salary. But if it is VF, visiting faculty, whatever they are receiving would be income from profession or income from other source. See, if I go for guest lecture at some university, we have, say, for example, IIM Ahmedabad, wherein assume I am going for the guest lecture twice in a year. They offer me some honorarium. That honorarium received by me would be income from other source. But assume I am a faculty at some college and I get the money. Whatever I receive would be my salary. Movie stars receiving the money. Say, for example, friends, Deepika Padukone receiving the money from the producer. Where it would be chargeable? See, when Deepika Padukone is doing some movie, there is a condition precedent that if she is doing the movie of X producer, there may be a condition precedent in her contract that she should not do the movie for some other producer, or she should do only 3 movies at a time or whatnot. But they are the terms of the contract. Terms of contract restricting you to do more work and work for one producer or 2 producer does not make your income chargeable under the head salary. Whatever the film stars, directors, musician, film artists receiving would be part and parcel of the professional income. Judges, undoubtedly, whatever they receive would be their salary income, would be their package, would be chargeable under the head salary. Now, as far as the taxability of the salary is concerned, since years, since the inception of the law, there is a lacuna. That lacuna goes this way, friends. Under the head salary, the taxability is on due or receipt earlier of the two. Meaning thereby, my salary, assume I am doing the job at X Private Limited, I would be taxed on due or receipt earlier of the two. But if you refer to section 192, that is TDS, which we generally don't read in depth. If we read 194J or 194C or 194H, the section says that TDS is required to be made on payment or credit, whichever is earlier. But if we refer to 192, that is the TDS on salary. It says TDS is required to be made only on payment. Meaning thereby, if assume I work for full 12 months with an employer X Private Limited, my salary is assumed 1 lakh rupee per month. Out of this 12 month salary, my employer has paid me 8 months salary only. He is going to make the TDS only on this 8 months salary. Under 192, he is required to make the TDS only on 8 months salary. But to me, the taxable would be full 12 months salary, because salary is taxable on due or receipt, whichever is earlier. It has become due. 12 month salary has become due. TDS is required to be made on, salary is taxable for full 12 months. But TDS is required to be made only on payment basis. If required, TDS is required to be made on payment basis. Here, the TDS would be only for 8 months salary, and there it is going to be a big mismatch. What would happen, friends, is that your TDS certificate, if your employer and his consultant is clever like you, then he's going to make the TDS only for 8 months. In your 26 years, only 8 months salary would be shown. But friends, here what is important is the taxability would be to the full year salary. So things will be problematic. Assume that's what I've discussed, salary due for the full year, but paid for the half year. Second will be our work for 12 months with X Private Limited. I said that, sir, there is COVID situation, so I want to change my home. Kindly give me the salary of next 4 months in advance. I worked for 12 months. My due is 12 months. My employer paid me 16 months salary. Now, if he pays me 16 months salary, it would be obligatory for him to make the TDS on 16 months salary in the current financial year. And the taxability to me would also be full 16 months salary. You will say that how 15 months salary, friends? Salary is going to be taxable on due or receipt, whichever is earlier. So if I have received another 4 months salary in advance, that would be taxable to me, not in the year in which it will become due. It would be taxable to me in the year in which it is received. So I'm going to be taxed for the same. Area of salary. Government is giving a sixth pay commission to the employee with retrospective impact. I'm working with government, let's assume. And my salary is, say, for example, 1 lakh rupee per month. Now, government has given me 10,000 rupees increment from last 5 years. So I am given last 5 years multiplied by 12 months, 60 months multiplied by 10,000 today. It would be taxable to me today because I was not knowing that I'm going to get the increment. It has neither become due earlier nor received. Arrear will be taxable only in the year of receipt. But friends, as arrear is taxable in the year of receipt, and because of this, there may be a huge amount which would be taxable to employee. The legislature has come out with relief under section 89(1) for this arrear as well as for this advance. Foregoing of salary and surrender of salary. See, due to COVID, if I forego the salary in favor of some trust registered under ATG, which is providing COVID relief to the victim, or which is providing food to poor people, friends, then it would be called a foregoing of salary. If it is foregoing of salary, the salary first comes to me and then I give it to the trust. So if my salary is 1 lakh and I forego 4,000, I would be taxed first full for 1 lakh rupees. And then that 4,000 rupees may be eligible for ATG, may not be eligible for ATG, depending upon the trust, whether registered for ATG or not registered, whether eligible for 50% or whether eligible for 100%. But if it is surrender of salary, as per the Surrender of Salary Act, assume that Kerala government comes out with the order, which says that all the state government employees are supposed to surrender 5% of their salary to the COVID relief fund. In that particular case, what happens is that here the person, an employee, has got 1 lakh rupee salary. From that 1 lakh rupee salary, assume my employee is surrendering 5,000. If he's surrendering 5,000 in support of the COVID, in favor of the COVID relief fund, then in that case, this is important. I am taxed only, and this is important, I am taxed only and only for 95,000. Because as far as the surrender of salary is concerned, it goes out of my hand before it reaches my hand. It is considered to be not application of income, but it is considered to be diversion of income. And if it is diversion of income, then in that particular case, it is not taxable to me at all. So that's how the things would be working in. If you are getting the salary from more than one employer, assume I'm doing the job with X Private Limited, I'm doing the job with Y Private Limited. I'm liable to show salary of both the employer. But it would be very important for me to see who is making my TDS. Assume I have disclosed about my employer employment with other employer to both the employers. Like I've said to X Private Limited that, sir, I'm working with Y also. I've said to Y that I'm working with X also. Then both would be making the TDS on their portion, considering salary from both the places. Considering my tax rate, because you are aware under Section 192, the TDS is required to be made on average rate. So considering the average rate on the basis of aggregate salary from X as well as from Y. But if, say for example, I have not disclosed about my employment at other place to any of the employer, then I am afraid employers are not at fault. I am going to face an issue. The reason being, assume I am getting 1 lakh from X Private Limited, they will consider my income to be 12 lakh less other deduction and exemption. And they'll make the TDS accordingly. I am getting 50,000 from Y Limited. Y Limited will consider my income to be 50,000 multiplied by 12 would be 6 lakhs less other deduction, other exemption, and will be making the TDS accordingly. I am able to enjoy the basic exemption limit of 2,50,000 twice plus concession rate of 5% and 20% also twice, which would not be the case when I file the rate, because the department knows that I have got the salary from two places. So I cannot file two return, friends, one from X Limited, one from Y Limited. I have to definitely aggregate my salary and I have to pay the tax at the rate applicable to me, which would definitely be 30% in this case. And if my TDS is made at a lower rate, it would be my duty to pay tax, maybe as advanced tax or maybe as self-assessment tax. I would here clarify one thing, and obviously our learned members are aware that yesterday's circular, which is issued by Central Board of Direct Taxes, says that the due date for the return and the tax audit report is extended. All of us are aware that the reason for this extension is not only the COVID, but also the web portal. The web portal is not functioning properly since, you are aware, 7th of June 2021. And still there are some glitches, not some, many glitches, I would say, in the portal. The unfortunate part is that we have not demanded the extension this time. It is not any association who is demanding the extension. It is on 20th May 2021 when the circular came, it was voluntary. On 9th September 2021, again when the circular came for extension, circular 17, yesterday's circular, it is voluntary. We have not gone to the court filing PIL, or we have not filed a read rather. We have not requested the CBDT or the finance ministry. It is voluntary because of the fault of the system. But unfortunate part is, they say that if you file your return after 31st of July 2021 for non-audit and 31st October 21 for audit assessee, then interest under Section 234A will be leviable if the self-assessment tax exceeds 1 lakh. This is not acceptable. When you give the extension freely. This is not our fault. My client wants to file. There may be around 300 returns which are ready at my place. I'm not able to suit. I'm not able to file because of the want of utility of 3CD. Someone messaged me immediately before this session that the utility of 3CD is available. Something, some form is available. He sent me the screenshot. Some office bearer from our association only sent me. So it must be authenticated. But it is on 10th of September, you are coming out with the utility. 31st July, your original due date, your system was not working. How can my assessee file the return? I know the argument from the side of the government would be pay tax. Read pay tax. But why should I be punished for the fault of the system. But friends, we are helpless. We cannot do anything. 234A will be leviable. All of you have read the circular well, but I thought just to highlight. For the academic reference, there are certain allowances which are being given over here. The allowances, see, salary comprises of various allowances, retirement benefit, perquisite. I know, friends, that this is one of the most dry topic I am handling. But I'll try to pick up the practical issues for the benefit of the members only, and especially told to me that medium base, small base form also in the salary as well as in other source clubbing also. There are certain allowances which are fully taxable, like entertainment allowance, DNS allowance, overtime allowance, non-practicing allowance, or servant allowance, project allowance, etc. But at the same time, there are certain allowances which are partly taxable and partly exempted. Now, if you check out with this partly taxable, partly exempt, you are aware, education allowance 100 rupee per month per child, maximum for two children, hostel 300 rupee, and so on and so forth. But the most important is the house rent allowance. If the employer is giving house rent allowance to the employee, then this house rent allowance can be exempted to the tune of section 10 bracket 30A, which says that the exemption will be actual HRA received, house rent allowance received, 40% of the basic plus DNS allowance if included for retirement benefit and commission percentage, 40% of salary. Salary comprises of these three. If the employment is in the metro city like Mumbai, Kolkata, Delhi, Chennai, then in that particular case, it would be in place of 40%. All of us are aware, 50%. And the third is important. Rent paid by the assessee less 10% of the salary. Meaning thereby, if the assessee has got the house rent allowance from the employer, but if he doesn't pay any amount of rent, then exemption of HRA is not available. Assume that I am an employee, I am getting HRA, I have not paid any rent because I am staying with my father, then I won't be able to enjoy any amount of HRA exempted. Assume I pay the rent to outsider, but my rent is not more than 10% of salary, then also I am not able to enjoy any exemption. But if my rent paid is 12% of my salary, assume my salary is 10 lakh and rent paid by me is, say for example, 1,20,000 rupees per annum, then my exemption will be 120, that is rent paid less 10% of 1 lakh, that is 1 lakh, only 20,000 rupees. Meaning thereby, unless otherwise I don't pay any rent, I'm not going to enjoy any exemption. Second important point is that if I pay the rent, but if the rent paid by me doesn't exceed 10% of salary, then also I'm not going to enjoy any exemption. But if my rent paid exceed 10% of salary, then only exemption is available. Coming to the planning end, I have said that I'm not paying any rent because I'm staying with my father. My father has the house, he's retired, he's owning the house, I'm staying, me and my family stays with him. I am getting salary from my employer, I am getting, say for example, HR. Can I make a planning of paying rent to my father? Answer is yes. If I pay the rent to my father, second question arises here is that whether it would be eligible for exemption in HRA, whether it would be counted in rent paid? Answer is yes. Third important question is, when I pay the rent to my father or my relative with whom I am staying, whether that relative is supposed to offer this as income? Yes. Under the head house property, my relative is supposed to offer this as an income. And from that house property income, my relative is going to get 30% standard deduction, so it would be an advantage to him. If he's falling under lesser slab than me, then also it would be an advantage to us jointly. Next question arises, whether I am supposed to make TDS from this rent under 194i? No, because 194i would be applicable only if I am covered by audit in the immediate preceding previous year. As I have said, I am an employee, I am not doing any business profession, so there is no question of audit, and hence 194i will not. Am I supposed to make TDS under any other section? Yes, 194ib. I may be hit if my per month rent exceeds 50,000 rupees. I have to make the TDS under 194ib if the per month rent exceeds 50,000, or I'm fulfilling the conditions of 194ib, and then only I'm going to get the deduction. The another important issue will be whether section 48(2) will be applicable here, that the payment should be reasonable. Answer is no. 48(2) is applicable only for business and profession. Here 48(2) will not come into play, but definitely if your case comes in the scrutiny, which is generally the rare case for the salaried person, but if it comes up for the scrutiny, I afraid the officer is going to check the same. So yeah, you can advise your client that they can pay the rent to their relative if they want to enjoy the exemption of the HRA, house rent allowance, but that should be a perfect planning. One more thing I would like to clarify here is that if corporation in our Ahmedabad, they are very strict. If the corporation comes to know that this is rented property, the municipal tax on such rented property is quite higher compared to the owned property. So that risk we have to keep in mind. This is legal bogus. Let us go to the practical one. One of my very good friend is working with a very renowned bank in Ahmedabad, and he's getting the pay from the bank. Now, all of us are aware that as an employee, we have to give a declaration to the employer for the TDS in the beginning of the year. So he came to me before giving that declaration, maybe 3 or 4 years back, 5 years back, that this is the declaration I'm trying to give. I said, fine, everything is fine. I mean, we have seen this. Okay, no, there is a change. The planning which we were making was, my friend was staying with his mother. Mother was owning the house. We were paying the rent to the mother. We were paying the rent to the mother, as I have said. We can make the planning, and we were making the planning. Employer was accepting. In the current year, or rather before the current year, he bought the adjoining flat in his own name. Like, his mother is staying in 301. He bought 302. Got the wall broken and made one unit. Now 301 belongs to mother. 302 belongs to my friend who is doing the job, who is an employee. For this 302, he took the loan from the same bank in which he is working, on which he is going to enjoy 24B interest house property, maximum 2 lakh. He may enjoy 80C if he wants principal amount repayment. So he gave in his declaration this 2 lakh rupee interest. Again, in the declaration, he said that give me the exemption of HRA also. I said, this is not available, dear. How can you enjoy the exemption of HRA as well as housing interest? Loan interest, housing loan interest, you cannot. He said, I am able to fulfill both the conditions. I am staying in 301, 302. Both are adjoining unit. You cannot segregate. Both are common dwelling unit. So I am able to enjoy both the exemption. Believe me, friends, I got confused. I said, wait, I referred to 1013A. One of the conditions given in 1013A is you must not be owning any other house at the workplace. If you are owning any other house at the workplace, you cannot enjoy 1013. So if you are owning 302 at workplace, you cannot pay the rent of 301 and enjoy 10-13. You pay the rent of 301, I don't mind, but you are not going to enjoy exemption of HRA. I said, you will not enjoy. He said, let me try. If my bank accepts, they'll make less tedious. He gave it to bank. Bank made less tedious. Bank accepted. When he came to my place for getting a return filed, I again warned him that even if your TDS certificate, salary certificate says 1013A as well as 24B, the system will not accept. He said, you file, if system doesn't accept, we'll see to it. Before 4 or 5 years, we filed the return, and friends, believe me, system has not accepted. System has not accepted before 4 to 5 years. Now, definitely they will not accept. So I said that come and pay the tax along with interest and pray God that there should not be any notice of concealment on you. Otherwise, things would be problematic. So I would definitely be requesting that don't make any planning which are suggested by the client. Make the planning which is legally correct, which is legally tenable in the eyes of it. If I go to the fully exempt allowances, certain allowances which are to high, which are given to High Court judge or the persons of UNO will all be fully exempted. Friends, certain perquisite which are tax planning device, telephone perquisite, you give mobile to your employee, it would be fully exempt. You give refreshment or you give subsidized lunch up to 50 rupee per lunch, it would be fully exempt. You expand something on the training of the employee, employee won't be taxed for the same, or leave travel concession also, it won't be taxable. I'm making a touch and go as far as the theoretical part is concerned. And now I make the comparison of allowance perquisite with the purpose of designing the pay package. Friends and members, will pick up some portion like education, conveyance, and so on, and we'll try to analyze how much benefit we can have. And this would be definitely useful for designing the pay package. If you have the small clients, employees, you can tell him that clear your salary is 12 lakh, make the planning so that you will be from 30% to 20% slab. Or if you have some corporate client, you can ask the HR that give us an opportunity to design the pay package for all your employees. This would be helpful. See, education. But before that, allowance means you are given a fixed amount. Employee is given a fixed amount, irrespective of the expenditure. While perquisite means on the basis of the actual amount, the payment is made by the employer. Like if HRA is given, I am given fixed amount by my employer, say 15,000 rupees per month. Pallab, you are given as house rent allowance, assume I am employee. Thereafter, I can take the house on rent worth 8,000 rupees per month, 12,000, 20,000 or 50,000 rupees per month. But if it is perquisite, I am given the flat by my employer, that this is a flat in my ownership, you go and stay there, is perquisite. I am given education allowance means fixed amount I am given, that for the education of my daughter, I am given, say for example, 5,000 rupees per month, irrespective of the fees of my daughter. But if it is perquisite, my daughter's fees is being paid by my employer. If it is education allowance, then exemption will be 100 rupees per month per child, maximum 2 children. But if it is education perquisite, assume my daughter is studying at X school, fees is, say for example, 60,000 rupees per annum paid by my employer, then it's my personal expenditure borne by my employer, it's a perquisite to me, 60,000 rupees. From this 60,000 rupees perquisite, I would be able to get 1,000 rupees per month per child as reduction. If 60,000 is given for my one daughter, my taxability will be 60,000 less 1,000 multiplied by 12,000, and 48,000 will be taxed. Friends, there are some judgments which are saying that if the perquisite given to you, education facility given to you is more than 1,000 rupees per month, then the whole amount will be taxable I would slightly differ. If it is 12,000 rupees per month per visit given, then only 200 will be taxable. Certain judgment says that 1,000 rupees is not the basic exemption given to you. They say up to 1,000 it is exempt, above 1,000 it could be fully taxable, just like our gift under the other source. Up to 50,000 it is exempt, above 50,000 it is fully taxable. In other source it's fine, but in perquisite I'll slightly differ. Here I go for the benefit of the perquisite and assume the employee has two children, 1,000 per month per child, maximum for two children, the exemption available will be 24,000 from the perquisite. Conveyance or motor car exempt to the extent expanded as far as the allowance is concerned. Friends, as far as the perquisite is concerned, motor car perquisite, there are different methodology for taxability. Here, I would prefer to get the allowance because I would be able to enjoy the exemption on the basis of the expenditure, on the basis of my petrol, on the basis of the maintenance, on the basis of repair, running, maintenance, etc. I assume that my job is far away. Assume I'm staying in Ahmedabad and my job is located at nearby city, say Gandhinagar, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not that clever geographically, but Cochin and nice place we had been, Kovalam. I think whether they are nearby, if I'm not mistaken, assume there is 1 hour drive. I'm staying in Ahmedabad, my job is located at Gandhinagar, or I'm staying in Cochin, I'm staying in Ernakulam, and my job is very nearby in the distance of say 50 minutes, 60 minutes. I'm going there by my car, my employer gives me conveyance, my expenditure. On the basis of the expenditure actual, I'm going to get the deduction. I'm assuming I'm able to get the deduction of 48,000 rupees per annum. Transport allowance, earlier 1,600 rupees was exempt. This was the planning done in all the pay packages, which is removed by Honorable the Finance Minister, ma'am. She said, now you would be able to get 50,000 rupees standard deduction. Assessment year 1920, it is removed, not by Honorable the Finance Minister, ma'am, by Mr. Arun Jaitley. Friends, park visit I'm not involving. This planning is now no more workable as it is done away, it has been omitted, it has been removed from the statute book. Accommodation. Friends, if I am given allowance, house rent allowance, we have discussed at length 10%. If I pay the rent worth more than 10% of the salary, I am able to enjoy the exemption. If it is park visit, 7.5% of my salary or 10% of salary or 15% of salary will be the taxable amount. I would advise you to select neither of the two. If you have the fund to buy the home, if you have the ability to take the loan and repay the loan for buying the home, then take the loan and try to avail the benefit under section 24B, that is interest on housing loan. As far as medical is concerned, medical allowance is fully taxable, so no planning is permitted. Medical perquisite was exempt up to 15,000 rupees as of today also, friends, and it's a good planning. Try and understand. Medical perquisite, if I analyze, if the employee is given the medical perquisite by the employer, meaning thereby, employer, say for example, Mr. X is an employee of TCS and Tata Group manages some hospital. Employee or relative of employee is admitted to that hospital, which is managed, owned by Tata Group. Then in that case, if employee is not charged or charged concessionally, the perquisite will be fully exempt. But if it is not owned or maintained by the employer, but if it is CCIT, Prince CCIT approved hospital, there is a procedure for approval you have to make. If it is approved hospital, then also the perquisite will be fully exempt in the hands of employee. If not, then 15,000 rupees was exempt earlier, balance was taxable. So what people were doing was, While designing the pay package, the employer was giving 15,000 medical per visit and they were asking the employees that get the bills of the medicine worth 15,000, get the reimbursement done. This 15,000 would be yours whether you've expended on medicine or not, and that amount won't be taxable to you. But now it is done away, so I cannot make any planning as far as the medical is concerned. Next one is uniform. Uniform allowance is exempt to the extent of expenditure. There is nothing like park visit. Select allowance. Now, this uniform allowance, there is a beauty. Uniform allowance does not only include uniform allowance. It includes the dry clean allowance also, attire allowance also. It includes laundry allowance also. So, employee can try to get the expenditure voucher, give it to employer, get the reimbursement, and or rather get the fixed money as allowance, but can enjoy the exemption on the basis of this vouchers available. The question here could be a very big one, that employer has decided to give say 4,000 rupees per month as uniform allowance to the employee. Now, when they have given uniform allowance to the employee, point to be noted is that here, when they are giving 4,000 rupees uniform allowance, in the beginning of the year, it is decided that 4,000 rupee uniform allowance is given. Now, the point is that from the same, my issue would be how to make the TDS, whether considering full 4,000 or certain exemption. Friends, before few years, it was permitted that employees would simply give a declaration in writing that they would expand this full 4,000 rupees, and employer was not asked to make the TDS. Employer was exempted from making TDS under Section 192. There were judgments available. Hindustan Unilever was the very important judgment in old days, which was saying that employer doesn't have any right to demand the proof of the expenditure which is going to incur for the uniform allowance or other allowances which are exempt on the expenditure basis. But now under Section 192 itself, there has been a mandate that you have to get the friends estimate. Along with estimate, you have to get the vouchers also. In the beginning of the year, you get estimate, but at the end of the year, just like ATC voucher or ATC receipts, you have to get the vouchers also. Otherwise, employer is duty bound to make the TDS. If you are able to manage for the vouchers of attire or uniform or laundry, or I would say the dry clean wagera, then it would be a win-win situation. Employer is ready to give you. You would be able to enjoy the exams. Books and periodicals, there is nothing like allowance, but if you are able to prove that you are buying it for the business purpose, professional purpose, which is going to give the benefit to the employer. I am working with some company as a chartered accountant. I am said that you can buy the book for the 50,000 rupees. I have bought Income Tax Act, Master Guide to Income Tax. I have bought other books for my reference. That books which I have purchased, Income Tax Act and Master Guide of Income Tax, is not going to help me achieving some personal purpose. I'm not going to go and I'm not going to go and deliver the lecture to my wife on the Income Tax Act. It would be helping my employer only, and it would be fully exempted. So I can make the planning worth, say, I have taken 15,000 rupees. Same way, food coupons is fantastic planning. 50 rupees per meal is exempt. Earlier, that Sodexo and Vagera was a big planning which people were making, corporates were making, which is, as I know, it's going on now also, but people were using Sodexo coupons for buying their grocery and other things, which is no longer now permitted. Now, many corporates have started giving food cards, 50 rupees per meal for 2 meals, would be exempt. I have taken 36,000. I would say reasonably it can be 30 or 24,000. Occasional gift up to 5,000 rupee, any gift will be exempted if employer gives. And you can make the planning of that 5,000 rupees. Telephone, as I have said, allowance is fully taxable, but perquisite will be fully exempt. My mobile bill is paid by my employer, then it is not taxable to me, even if some part of my mobile bill is for person. 2,000 rupees the monthly bill, let's assume, multiplied by 12 would be exempt. Personal accident will be fully exempt, and you can avail the standard deduction of 50,000. Now, if you combine all these things, except 24B house loan interest, your benefit exclusively from the topic salary is 2,65,000, which is, believe me, too less. The next planning can be by way of LTC. Many companies are having the tendency to offer the LTC to the employee for going on leave or after retirement or termination of the services going to their home district. It is available to employee dependent relative. It is given by employer for employee as well as for dependent relative, and it would be available for the relative, which covers spouse, children, parents, and brother sister. Children would cover only two children, maximum for two children, and your relatives would be dependent on. Your spouse is also to be dependent on you, children also to be dependent on. Assume I'm going on leave, on holidays with my wife, my daughter, my father, mother, and my real brother, sister. I would be able to avail the exemption. For all subject to, I have to prove that my father, mother, as well as my brother, sister, as well as my spouse is dependent on me. Then only. Now the exemption would be available only on the basis of the actual expenditure made. My employer gives me the leave travel concession worth, say for example, 1 lakh. I would be able to enjoy the exemption on the basis of not full 1 lakh, but on the basis of the actual expenditure I have incurred. You can excuse me this. Ravi bhai, ek webinar lo shu. Friends, exemption would be available for the actual expenditure I have incurred. Now the point to be noted is that my exemption will be on producing the travel tickets, travel charges, and I would be able to enjoy the exemption only twice in the block of 4 calendar years. This calendar years, I repeat, it is calendar years. This calendar years are prescribed in the law itself. Unfortunately, 2020, due to COVID, people could not travel and could not avail. So there were some other exemptions given that you expand, and on the expenditure you have 12% GST for any goods or services you buy, then also exemption of LTC will be available. In spite the name is leave travel concession, without travel also the exemption was granted by the Honorable the Finance Minister, looking at the circumstance. I'm not involving myself into the same, as now it is not available. But the exemption would be available twice, two times in the block of 4 calendar years. And assume that you are not able to proceed on the leave two times in the block of 4 years, then avail it for 1 year, avail it one time, and one you can carry forward to be availed in the first year of the next block, meaning thereby you are given you are given exemption for two times in the block of 4 years. You can avail the exemption only once. One you can carry forward, but that carried forward has to be availed in the fifth year, which is the first year of the next block. If you could not avail, then it lapses. If you could avail in the first year of the next block, that is fifth year, then in fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth, again you can enjoy two. If you are not able to enjoy two, you are able to avail only one, then one you can carry forward and avail in the ninth year. If you are not able to avail in the ninth year, it will lapse. Let us assume that in first to fourth year, you could not avail both. then you can carry forward only one. If you can carry forward only one, that has to be availed in the 1 mil lapse. One will be carried forward, which is to be availed in the fifth year only. But the exams are on the basis of the actual ticket. How much would be the exams? For air, it is not exceeding any economy class airfare. But if it is rail, then air condition first class rail fare by the shortest route. But if it is, say, for example, by car or road, then the road trans, ST, state transport facility by the shortest route would be eligible for exams. Friends, next is pretty burning, and I'm trying to now take you to the actual area which may affect. Earlier it was affecting only higher class, but now it may affect even upper middle class employees also. Many companies as of today, as the Sensex is achieving new and new heights, the stock market is going up like anything. Many companies, to attract their employee to remain in the job, offers ESOP called Employee Stock Option Plan. Company is giving this to the employee. Now, if we look at the taxability will be for employee, the difference between the fair market value of the shares and the issue price of the ESOP would be taxable as salary in the year in which ESOP is exercised. If I elaborate, assume I'm working with X Limited, I'm given the ESOP at 700 rupees, my market value is say 800 rupees, then this 100 rupee difference, the market value and the amount at which I am offered, the benefit which I have derived is 100 rupee, that 100 rupee will be taxable to me under the head salary perquisite, and it would be taxable to me in the year in which I exercise this. Now, when I sell off these shares, I would be able to deduct the market. I'll be able to deduct the market value for the purpose of computing the capital gain, because I've already paid the tax on the difference between the fair market value and the offer price. Honorable Finance Minister, to give the boost to the startup, and I am aware, friends, that Kerala, Ernakulam, in all the field, I would say, very genius brains are there in Kerala. There may be number of startups which are registered in Kerala. And if your employer is a startup and eligible for deduction under Section 80IAC of the Income Tax Act, fulfilling all the conditions of 80IAC, then the employee can postpone the taxability on the difference between fair market value of the shares and the offer price. That difference, which is apparently taxable under their salary, can be postponed by the employee. It can be postponed by the employee. There is a specific formula given by the Honorable the Finance Minister. It can be postponed by the employee to 48 months. How come it can be postponed now? For those employees of the eligible startup, it would be taxable after expiry of 48 months of the end of the relevant assessment year. But before that, assume the lock-in period ends and the employee sells off the shares, then the difference between sales price and the fair market value would be capital gain, and difference between fair market value and the offer price would be salary income in the year of sale itself. Assume employee leaves the job, then the taxability arises in the year of leaving the job. So 48 months is a general thing, assuming he is neither selling nor leaving the job. If he sells or leaves, it would be taxable all year of the two in the hands of the employee. Second thing is, if you are contributing to, or rather if employer is contributing to certain retirement benefit account of the employee, earlier, contribution by employer on behalf of employee to the superannuation fund exceeding 150 was taxable. So if employer is contributing to superannuation fund 160, 10,000 was taxable in old year. Now you've changed the mechanism. This mechanism is changed, if I'm not mistaken, from PY 2021 onwards. Now they say that any contribution made by employer on behalf of employee to recognized provident fund, it was not covered earlier, now it is recognized provident fund, national pension scheme, and approved superannuation fund. Aggregate of these three up to 7,50,000 is not taxable. Balance will be taxable. So if my employer has contributed to my recognized provident fund 4 lakh, my NPS 2 lakh, and say for example to superannuation fund 1,60,000, then aggregate is, friends, 750 is exempt, 10,000 will be taxable. But assume to my PF he has contributed 7 lakh, he has contributed to my NPS 2 lakh, and to this superannuation fund 160, 7 plus 2 plus 160 will be 1060, if I'm not mistaken, less 750, 310 will be taxable to me. Earlier this, I would say, this RPF and NPS was not covered. Now they've covered everything. Not only this, friends, the interest or dividend on the above should also be taxable in the hands of employee. You've seen, friends, since couple of years, the target of the Honorable the Finance Minister is on the retirement benefits of the employee. It was 17.2, which was modified to 750 to cover everything. And now in the current year, they've modified the rule related to employee contribution. I'm not picking up this gradually. I'm giving it for the academic purpose of yours, because I'm aware that it would be applicable to very, very rare persons, rare participants. Friends, let me straight away check out with, because my intention is to cover the old regime and new regime also in first 1 hour, 40 minutes covering pay package, and thereafter it will be other source and clubbing. See, I would put this way, friends, here my important issue is that, see, friends, the amount which is lying to the recognized provident fund or statutory provident fund of the employee was fully exempt up to 31st March 2021, but the Honorable the Finance Minister made a big change. The Honorable the Finance Minister came out with the change saying, just a moment please, that now the provident fund interest on contribution made on or after 1st April 2021 is going to be taxable. And the taxability will arise not on receipt basis, but accrual basis. How this taxability will arise? Friends, now in the bill, there was some different thing. When it has become an act, it was different. And luckily, to clarify the act, very recently, the clarification has come that we have to have two PF account, one for taxable portion and one for exempt portion. We are discussing on that. Now, the provision as of today is, this is to restrict. You are aware in PF, you are getting very high rate of return, high rate of interest. Second is that as far as this PF is concerned, employee can voluntarily contribute any amount to the PF account. There is no restriction. In my PPF account, I can contribute only 1,50,000. In employee PF account, no restriction as such. So employees to play safe for contributing huge amount as voluntary contribution to their own PF account, government wanted to restrict this. Because on PF, the interest rate is above 8%, on FD, it is around 6%. So they are benefited if they contribute, and PF interest is exempt on salary. I'm sorry, FD interest will be taxable. The Honorable Finance Minister brought in saying that if employer is also contributing to PF, an employee contributes, then up to 2,50,000 rupee contribution, whatever the interest you receive will be exempt. Above that, it would be taxable. But if employer is not contributing, then above 5 lakh contribution made by employee, the interest will be taxable. If I elaborate, assume the employer is, sorry my mistake, employee is contributing to the PF account 7 lakh rupees. Whether employer contributes? No. Then interest on 5 lakh is exempt. Interest on 2 lakh will be taxable. The confusion which I was expecting was that how to segregate this 5 and 2, but clarification is issued last week. I'm coming. Assume employee contributes 4 lakh. Whether employer contributes? No. Then interest on full 4 lakh will be exempt because the limit is 5 lakh and nothing will be taxed. Important now. If employer also contributes and employee is contributing 3,80,000, third illustration I am in, then on 2,50,000 rupee, the interest will be exempt. On 1,30,000 rupee, interest will be taxable. First year solution has come. But assume I have 20 lakh rupee in my PF account, which is including employer contribution and employee contribution till 31st March 21, and which includes the accumulated interest also. Now in the current year, employee has contributed 3,80,000 and employer has contributed 3 lakh. So 20 plus 3 plus 380 will be totaling 26,80,000, of which 1,30,000 rupee contribution interest will be taxable and 25,50,000 rupee contribution interest will not be taxable. Agreed, first year justifiable. How about second year? Because in second year, again, if there is same contribution, 3 lakh by employer, 380 by employee, then 130 contribution of the current year, 130 contribution of the earlier year, plus earlier year contribution interest, aggregate of the two, aggregate of the three, and interest on the same will be taxable on balance. It would be exempt. It would be a too tough exercise. Sir, it would be a very, very difficult exercise. Honorable the Finance Minister, ma'am, said that if you want to contribute above 5 lakh or above 2,50,000, as the case may be, prepare to separate account, open to separate account of the PF, contribute 250 in the exempt portion, 130 in the taxable portion, non-taxable portion, whatever the interest you receive every year will be taxable, be it be interest on 130 or next year interest on interest also, it would be taxable. And on the exempted part of the PF contributed by you, you will not be taxed on any amount. 220 if he's contributing, employer also contributes, nothing will be taxed. Friends, I'm aware that there was a separate portion on general deduction, so I'm not involving myself much into the same, but there can be the ATC deduction to the employee worth 1,50,000 with, as of today, the taxability of the ULIP. You are aware, employee can avail ATCCD. Also, employer contribution is eligible for full deduction. Employee contribution would be part of ATCCE, bearing 50,000 rupees, which would be eligible under section ATCCD 1B. Even I would advise our members, even if in the practice, to go for NPS. NPS, the notified pension scheme of the central government, is not that much marketed by the investment consultant, as they are getting very, very less commission on the same. But otherwise, it's a very good area of tax saving. I know that it is only 50,000 rupees you can save under ATCCD 1B, but that 50,000 tax on 50,000 at the rate of 30%, if you are falling in, would be 15,000 rupees. It's a good amount, handsome amount. And friends, return on this NPS is also in 2-digit. People were saying return name. There is no return. There is no return. No, it is not. Return is also 2-digit. You can invest to avail the exemption. ATD, I can have mediclaim for myself for 25,000, my parents for another 25,000. If my parents are senior citizen resident, then in place of 50,000 rupee also I can avail not only medical insurance premium. If I could not get the medical insurance of my parents because of the age or because of some other reason and they are senior citizen resident and I have to expend for their medical treatment, then expenditure on medical treatment is also eligible for the deduction to me. Same thing, preventive health checkup would also be eligible for deduction worth maximum 5,000 rupees. There are some illustration given, I'll be sharing it for your benefit, but not involving myself into the same presently. Even housing loan interest also I can avail. So what I'm trying to do is that original package we have planned plus the other area of good planning will be the contribution by employer to the recognized provident fund. On LinkedIn, I was seeing one post that your CTC is not your take home. Because from CTC, there is going to be the deduction of PF, there is going to be the deduction of some other contribution you are making. If NPS is there, there would be definitely TDS and number of things. So your employer contributing to your recognized provident fund account, I assume it is up to 7,50,000 looking at that new rule. But if your salary is 12 lakh and is contributing 12%, then 1,44,000 will be exempted. Assume employee has taken the housing loan, interest on the same is 2 lakh, which would be eligible for deduction in the HP, house property, and eligible for set off in the salary. ATC deduction worth 1,50,000, CCD 1B worth 50,000, and CCD 2 of the employer worth say 10% of the salary, 1,20,000, and ATD 25,000 mine, 50,000 for my parents. In aggregate, it comes to 7,39,000 rupee is the benefit I am availing. Look at the point. This benefit which I am availing is only for the points which I have mentioned on this slide. Plus, in the salary, I said about some other benefits also. I don't know how much I have said there. Roughly 2 lakh and some figures I said, if you recollect, I'll check once. Yeah. It was 2,65,000 plus this. Obviously, cannot be aggregated. This would be only when your salary is above 20, above 25. You can have all this. But see, friends, if you take the shelter of the topics other than salary, here you see, except 1,44,000, nothing belongs to the topic salary. This 2 lakh belongs to house property and rest belong to chapter 6A. I can in aggregate make the planning of 10 lakh, not more than that. And 10 lakh is also on a very, very higher side, friends, I am saying. So you cannot have the planning like business and profession, in which we always ask the client how much tax you want to pay and I will adjust. That is not possible in the salary. In fact, I would not advise anyone to make the adjustment in this fashion in the business also. But friends, this is the basics about the same. Now, the very important, I know that it is not exactly the salary topic, but I've been asked to highlight, and I'm trying to highlight combining it with the TDS issue. Friends, there is a new tax regime which is given by the finance ministry. It says for individual HUF from the financial year 2021, the along with old, you can select new also, or rather from old and new, you can select one. The old regime, you are aware, is 2,50,000 rupees zero, 2,50,000, 1 to 5 lakh, 5%, 5 lakh to 10 lakh, it is 20%, and above 10 lakh, it would be 30%. While in the new regime, it is set up to 2,50,000 zero, 5 lakh, 5%, 7,50,000, 10%, 10 lakh, 15%, 12,50 tak, 20%, up to 15 lakh, it would be 25%, and above 15, it would be 30%. You can select this option. Now, given an option, definitely people will go for this. Why people will go for this? Because there would be less tax payable. But this is the government wherein they are giving it from one hand, they are taking away from 10 hands. Government says that if you want to have this new tax regime under 115 BAC1, you should be giving up the benefits provided under 115 BAC2. What you have to give up is, for employee, standard deduction 50,000, professional tax, other allowance exemption is not available. Employee or any person cannot get interest on self-occupied property or vacant property. If his property is let out, he can get the interest deductible, but due to interest, if there is loss, then such loss cannot be set off against any other head. For old tax regime, up to 2 lakh rupee loss can be set off. Here it cannot be. For businessmen, additional depreciation is not available. Scientific research donation is not available. In-house research expenditure is available, but donation is not available. You also cannot get the benefit of 35AD or 35CCC. Family pension deduction is not available. And deduction under section 80C, chapter 6A deductions, are not available. Now, if I go to practical issue, assume your salary is like 6,50,000 rupees, and you go to old regime, 50,000 is a standard deduction, you comes to 6 lakhs. And on 6 lakhs, as per the old regime, the tax will be 2,50,000 zero, 2,50,000 to 5 lakh, 5%, and 5 to 6 lakhs, it would be 20%, comes to 30 to 500. As per the new regime, you forgo standard deduction, but you can get the concessional rate. Your tax rate will be 250 zero, 250 to 5. It would be 5%. 5 to 650, it would be 10%. And your tax comes to 27,500, friends. I've ignored the 4% health and education says here. But if you go to the new regime, there is a tax benefit of 5,000. Advantageous for the employee or for the assessee. Now, if I generalize how I have derived that 5,000 rupee benefit. Employee, if goes for the old rate, above 5 lakh, there is 1 lakh rupee income because he is able to get standard deduction of 50,000. And on 1 lakh, he ends up paying 20% tax. So that comes to 20,000. If he goes to the new regime, he is not able to get standard deduction. So above 5 lakh, there is an income worth 1,50,000. And on 1,50,000, the tax rate will be not 20%, but it would be concessional tax 10%. So tax comes to 15,000, and there is a benefit of 5,000 rupees. Friends, assume he is getting salary of 9,50,000. Now, from 9,50,000, standard deduction of 50,000, and he has contributed 650. There was no choice with the employee to make any saving, make any investment. Out of 6,50,000, what he will earn, what he will save, and what he will expand. Right. So I've assumed he has not saved anything. But here, he has made the investment worth 1 lakh. So in old regime, you can get standard deduction and investment, and your taxable income will be 8 lakh. As per the old tax rate, 70 to 500 will be the tax. You go to the new regime. In the new regime, sorry, you cannot get standard deduction. You cannot get any. ATC, your income will be 950, applying the tax rate 5% up to 5 lakh, 5 to 750, 10% and 750 to 950 at 15%. Friends, there is tax coming to 67,500. Again, there is an advantage of 5,000. I know that you are going to tell me that whether this new regime will be advantageous always, answer is no. the more you invest, the new regime becomes, I would say, or more you want and more you invest, the new regime becomes disadvantageous. How? I'm trying to justify. Assume your salary along with other income. I'm assuming other income also is there. Salary I've written, but there is other income also. Worth the 13 lakh, 12 lakh salary and 1 lakh other income. Out of which he is able to enjoy 50,000 rupees standard deduction. He has invested full 1,50,000 in PPF. He paid medical leave of himself 25, parents 25. And from other source, there is saving interest. He is able to enjoy 10,000 rupees ATTTA in the old regime. Yes, he is able to enjoy all this. His income comes to 10,40,000 and tax payable on 10,40,000 comes to, friends, tax payable on 1040 comes to 1,24,500. But if we go for the new regime, on 13 lakh, neither you can get standard deduction, nor you can get ATC, nor you can get ATD, nor you can get ATTTA. Your income taxable will be 13 lakh and your tax payable will be 137,500. Unfortunately, you are at a disadvantage of 13,000 if you select to go for the new regime. Please be careful before advising your client. I'm coming to the generalizer. I'm coming to the shortcut. Assume your salary along with other income is 20 lakh. He's able to get 50,000 standard deduction in the old regime. He has purchased the house as he has started earning good. Purchased the house on the loan, paying the loan interest 2 lakh, which is eligible for 24B deduction. Live 150, he could make NPS also. He could get mediclaim also and 10,000 in FB interest also. So 1440, 244,500 is the tax as per the old rate. Old rate is 5%, 20% and 30%. But if it is 20 lakh, and my client is opting for the new regime, I afraid in new regime, he's not going to enjoy any benefit. If he's not going to enjoy any benefit, then tax on 20 lakh as per new regime will be 337,500. Friends and members, look at the disadvantage in the new regime. It is worth 93,000 rupees. I would put this way. And now the shortcut. Up to 250, whether it is old or new, same rate. 2,50,000, 1 to 5 lakh, whether it is old or new, same rate. 5 lakh, 1 to 7,50,000. In old 20%, in new 10%. So there is an advantage of 10%, old 20, new 10. So difference is 10% on 5 lakh, 1 to 7,50,000, that is 2,50,000. 10% advantage will give you 25,000 benefit in the new regime. 7,50,000, 1 to 10 lakh, old regime 20%, new regime 15%, the advantage is 5%. On 250, 5% advantage is 12,500 in the new regime. Third, 10 lakh 1 to 12,50,000 in old regime 30%, in new regime 20%, the advantage is 10%. 12,50,000, 1 to 15 lakh, advantage is 5%. In place of 30, it is 25. Now, relevant. Above 15 lakh, there is no advantage because the tax rate is similar. The point to be taken care of is the total advantage, friends, you can have in the new regime is only and only, friends, can I say 75,000. Now the point to be taken care of is, if your salary or income is around 20 lakh, shifting from old to new will give you a tax advantage of 75,000. That's clear. But if you are able to enjoy the standard deduction or ATC or ATD or 24B or F, the other benefits, which are not available in the new but available in the old, worth more than 2,50,000. How come I'm getting the figure of 2,50,000? Your advantage, tax advantage is 75 in the new regime. Now 75 divided by 30 multiplied by 100 will give you 2,50,000, meaning thereby in the new regime, you are not going to enjoy all these benefits, which in old you can avail. In old or new, if your income is around 20 lakh, you fall under 30% slab. So if you are able to get 2,50,000 tax advantages, ATC, ATD, 24B and whatnot, you would be able to save 30% tax. That is 75,000. So if your income is around 20 lakh and your tax advantages are, this ATC, ATD, 24B worth is around 2,50,000. Is around 2,50,000. Whether you go to or exactly equivalent to 2,50,000, whether you go to old or new, it would be similar. Make the calculation. 250 is your ATC, ATD, 20 lakh income. Whether you go for old, whether you go for new, your tax amount would remain same. Your advantages are less than 2,50,000, the new will be beneficial. Your advantages are more than 2,50,000, old will be beneficial. If you are able to enjoy 3 lakh rupee or 4 lakh rupee benefit out of 20 lakh, then on 4 lakh availing all these benefit, you are able to save 4 lakh multiplied by 30%, that would be 1,25,000. If you are going for the new regime, you have to forgo this 4 lakh, and on 20 lakh you would end up paying tax, wherein you are saving will be only 75,000. So simple answer will be to your client, what is your income? What are your advantages which you have to forgo in the new, which you are otherwise able to enjoy in the old? If these two questions are answered by the client, it would be pretty simple for you to select old or new. Nowadays, the system is giving us the facility. When you want to go for the another illustrations I have given of the family and the planning, not involving, I'm giving it for your benefit. Here I've tried that one family member, husband should go for the new one and wife should go for the old one, or vice versa. I've given saying that husband should go for the old, whole investment should be made by husband, let him enjoy the old, and wife should go for the new without making any investment. But if you want to make more investment in ATC, ATD, both husband and wife wants to invest 150, 150, then that illustration number 5 is not workable. You have to come to the illustration number 6 I have given. Exercising option is now very simple, as system itself says. You want to opt for 115 BAC, you have to select this while filing the return under 139.1. Once you select the option, it would be access applicable to all the years if it is business income which is there in your return. And if you've gone to new regime, then you can only once in your lifetime come back to the old. But once you are back to old, now you cannot go to the new. But if you don't have business income, don't worry, every year you can change the option. It may be first year new, second year old, third year old, fourth year new, fifth year old, and so on and so forth is permitted. Friends, some small issues to close my first part. Can you enjoy 87A benefit in the new regime? I know that your answer question will be that up to 5 lakh, whether we go for old or new, doesn't make any difference. Assume, friends, I have got a business income and last year I have taken the new regime. Current year, I want to be in the new regime. I don't want to be back to the old so as to have old every year. So I want to be in the new regime, but my income is around 4 lakh and I want to say enjoy 87A rebate. Would I be able to enjoy? Answer given is yes. There is no prohibition, so there is permission. Whether senior citizen and super senior citizen would have any enhanced basic exemption limit in the new regime? 3 lakh or 5 lakh rupee? Answer is no. Senior and super senior would have to settle at 2,50,000 only. This has happened with one of my relatives. My relative is doing the job in a corporate. In the year 2021, when asked by the HR department, he said that I want to get my TDS deducted as per the new regime. It was new, so people were fond of new regime and said new regime. TDS is done as per new regime. Now this year, HR raised the same issue. HR mailed to her, said new or old. She said new. HR again mailed. That are you sure? She said yes. HR gave a call to her that, ma'am, check out with your chartered accountant. that relative of mine is not a chartered accountant. Her husband is chartered accountant, but her husband is not in the practice or job. Her husband is running a factory. So she said that my husband is chartered accountant, and I've asked him. HR said that your husband, ma'am, I am aware, is not in the practice. Ask the chartered accountant who is filing your return. So she called me. I asked only two questions. What is your salary? She said 27 lakh. What are your investments along with 24B? What are your tax advantages? She said around 4 to 5 lakh. Undoubtedly, the answer would be old age. I said old. That's why she said that HR is repeatedly asking me. That then she said that last year I have got my TDS done as per the new regime. Advisable for her to file the return as per the old regime. Can she file? Answer is yes. She can file. Point number 3 and 4, I've already discussed. Rather, there is some mistake in the numbering. I'm doing it on my own, so kindly pardon, friends. Business profession 3 and 4, both I have done. Friends, I have filed my original return as per the old regime, as per the new regime. And now I want to revise it as per the old regime. Is it permitted? Revised return limit is also been enhanced. Can I revise as per the old regime? Answer is no, because this option is to be selected under 139.1 only, not under 139.4 or 139.5. Revised return is under 139.5. You cannot change the option, in my humble opinion. What system would do, God knows. Earlier, my senior members are aware that act was belated return cannot be revised. System was allowing the revision of belated return also. Nowadays, the act is modified. So if this problem persists in the system, they will make the modification. And the last, non-resident individual, NHUF wants to take the advantage of new regime. Can they take? There is no prohibition like 87A. 87A rebate is available only to individual resident, while this new regime is available to all individual HUF, whether resident or non-resident. They can get the benefit of the new regime. It is perfectly permitted to them. Friends, this is what is my presentation on the pay package, salary, recent changes in the salary, and the old regime, new regime. With this, I am proposing, planning to go for the next portion which is allotted to me. But two things before I go ahead. It's been 1 hour and 30 minutes I have spoken, and it is one way. Is it going at the proper speed and proper direction before I go to my next presentation? If I'm actually new to this Cisco WebEx, we use it only for our tribunals. And should we take 5-minute tea break or should we continue?
Sir, we may take a break. We've got 2 questions, if you don't mind.
No, please, we can. Yeah, yes, I got the chat box and question answered. Yes, sir.
It's in the Q&A box. I'm not sure if you've received anything privately.
No, sir.
Okay. So the question by Shrikumar, sir, is that, is the stipend paid by hospitals for doctors who have joined for DNB course, whether the same will come under section 1016? But the hospitals take the stipend and salary and insist for TDS. Please advise on how TDS can be avoided, sir.
Okay, I have to advise avoidance of TDS. Okay, I'll give the exact legal position. Under section 1016, any sort of stipend is exempted. Now, stipend means the amount given by the employer or the place wherein you are working to meet your cost of education. Generally, the cost of medical education is very high. So we can get the shelter of 10 bracket 16, there is no problem at all. But if you ask me the legal position, unfortunately, few years back, fringe benefit tax was inserted. And in the FBT, on this stipend, they have, which was earlier called scholarship 1016, that is to meet the cost of education. On scholarship, they have levied the FBT on the payer, that is the employer. Yes, they have levied the FBT, which is to be borne and which is to be paid by the employer. Employer changed their stand from that very year, considering the stipend to be taxable in the hands of the receiver, and it would be considered as salary income, or Big Four to their article may be giving it as professional income. But if you, as of today, as we all of us are aware that there is no FBT. So as of today, if you want to take the shelter of 10 bracket 16 and avoid the TDS, your simple argument should be that it is to meet the cost of education to the medical student only. The amount of stipend is not more than that. It is equivalent to or lower than that. And you can try and convince the avoidance of the TDS. Right? Whether the employer will agree or the payer will agree or not is a difficult thing. But yes, you can definitely try and avoid on this particular argument. Yes, sir. Second one, sir, should I read?
I can read it for you, sir. The yes, other sir. One is from Bryony Jacob, madam, where she's asking, an SSC joined the company in 2018 and the EPF contribution is 49,000 by employer and employee. He resigned in 2020 and has still not withdrawn the amount yet. What would be the taxable portion?
The rule is, if you withdraw from the RPF account within 5 years, then amount will be taxable. Now, if I'm not mistaken, as per the PF Act, you can keep this money in the PF without transferring your PF account to the new employer for 3 years, for which I think, if I'm not mistaken, interest won't be paid to you. But if your client is planning, or the assessee is planning, to join some other employer, then it is advisable to get the PF account transferred in the name of other employer, and there won't be any taxability. But if not, then I afraid the withdrawal is advisable to be made, and the amount will be taxable in the hands of the employee in the year of withdrawal only. So there is no benefit. If you're planning to join somewhere else, keep it in the PF account and get it transferred to the new employer whenever you join. Otherwise, withdraw, pay the tax. Sir, any other question?
Sir, we've just got one question. It's received in private. Whether is it available to an employee having speculative business intraday trading? Do they have the option to convert to old regime after selecting new regime 1 year?
If I'm not mistaken, the question is, I'm an employee doing the job, earning the salary. Along with that, I've started intraday, which is shown by me as my business and profession income. Now, option would be with me only once. Whether, if I have gone for the new, I can go back to old, and then I have to remain in the old only. But assume that in subsequent year, I stop doing intraday. Assume market cracked and I made a huge loss and I stopped doing intraday. Now my return is only having salary income. Can I change it from new to old? Yes. Again, can I change it from old to new? Yes. Can I change it again? Yes, subject to I don't have business and profession income. But if I continue with intraday, it is part and parcel of my business profession income. If I'm showing it as my business, then the change of option is just like given as if you have the business and profession income.
Perfect, sir. Perfect. So I think we could go for a quick 5-minute break if it is okay with you. I'm
I,
sure the
sir, I'm
customers are
comfortable
very
if
happy.
members are comfortable. And whether the
I'm
pace
sure.
is okay, pace with which
Pace is
I'm
fine,
using.
sir. Absolutely, sir. Absolutely fine. Absolutely. It's
So
been very clear and crystal clear so far.
thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thanks, organizers and members. Will 5 minutes, sir?
5 minutes will be great, sir.
Right, sir,
Thank you.
right, sir, thanks. I'm available whenever it is convenient.
Perfectly ready to start, sir.
All right. So, yes, seniors and my dear friends, I go to the next portion of my presentation, and that is the important issues on income from other source, including plowing. Now, other source has got only four sections, wherein I would not be touching upon the issues which are not much relevant. I would pick up issues related to dividend, including deemed dividend under 222E especially. I would pick up the provisions which are connected with 56(2)(7B). At the same time, I would check out with the provisions which are related to gift taxability in certain specified cases. Dividend, a big change made by the finance minister from the financial year 2021, making the dividend taxable in the hands of the shareholder. And this has made a big effect. Friends, all of us are aware that earlier there was dividend distribution tax which was payable by the company and in the hands of the shareholder up to 1 lakh, sorry, up to 10 lakh rupee dividend was totally exempted. Now, about 10 lakh, it was taxable under 115 BBDA at the rate of 10%. But now that 1034, which was exempting the dividend, or 115O, which was talking about the DDT, has been abolished, and dividend will be taxable to the shareholder in the hands of the shareholder under the head income from other source at the rate applicable to the shareholder. 115 BBDA has got no value now. Very first rupee. So, as the dividend is taxable from the very first rupee, the connected chain of sections which I propose to discuss are 115(1)(a) abolished, 1034, 1035 abolished, 194 and 194K TDS, 115 BBDA talks about that 10%, section 57 something very awkward said, and section 80M intercompany intercorporate dividend. And we'll be analyzing foreign company dividend also. Let us begin with the first portion. 115(1)(a) old and new 80M. Friends, 115(o) was on dividend distribution tax paid by the company on the dividend distributed. So the section was saying that assume Palak Limited got the dividend from X Limited. So X Limited in old days must have paid the DDT. Palak Limited, the dividend is exempted. Now when Palak Limited distributes the dividend to their own shareholder, whether Palak Limited has to pay DDT because Palak Limited is distributing the dividend from the dividend received from X Limited, and X Limited has already paid the DDT, again whether Palak Limited is supposed to pay DDT? The answer was if Pollock Limited has got the dividend from X Limited and X Limited is subsidiary company of Pollock Limited, whether Indian or whether foreign subsidiary company of Pollock Limited, and Pollock Limited is holding company. Now, when Pollock Limited distributes the dividend, Pollock Limited was not required to pay DDT. It was allowed to be set off under 115(o)(1A) of the Income Tax Act. But there the condition was, it is from subsidiary company you receive the dividend and you distribute, you don't have to pay DDT. ATM is the new section. As we are aware, 115(o) is abolished. 01A is also no longer required. But similar type of section inserted in the legislature is section ATM, which says that if Pollock Limited receives the dividend from X Limited, and now Pollock Limited distributes the dividend to their own shareholder, then dividend received by Pollock Limited from X Limited is chargeable to Pollock Limited under the head income from other sources. Chargeable to Pollock Limited under the head income from other source. And when Pollock Limited distributes this dividend, Pollock Limited would be able to enjoy deduction under section 80M to the extent dividend received or to the extent dividend distributed, whichever is less. Important point to note here is that X Limited may be Indian company, X Limited may be foreign company. Pollock Limited receiving dividend and distributing to their shareholder, whatever is distributed or received, lesser of the two will be deductible under ATM. Very second important point is to be noted is that here X Limited may be subsidiary company, may be non-subsidiary company. Pollock Limited getting dividend and distributing, Pollock Limited would be able to enjoy ATM, meaning thereby Pollock Limited got the dividend from Reliance Industries Limited during the year worth 10,000. And Pollock distributed to their own shareholder worth 8,000. 8,000 is ATM. Pollock distributed to their own shareholder worth 80,000. 10,000 will be ATM. ATM is available whether the company from which you are receiving dividend may be subsidiary, may not be subsidiary. So this is a broader section than 115(o)(1A), a beneficial section. Second section inserted by the legislature, or rather, second small portion inserted by the legislature is section 57. 57 says any expenditure incurred for the purpose of funding the dividend is eligible for deduction. Or rather, actual 57 should have been, my mistake, should have been any expenditure for earning dividend should be eligible for deduction. But Honorable the Finance Minister Ma'am has said only interest expenditure for earning taxable dividend is eligible for deduction. Any other expenditure not allowed, like collection charge, like X, like Y, all other expenditure, you are not going to get the deduction. You have taken the loan for the purpose of making investment in the shares, and on loan you are paying the interest, whether the loan is from bank, NBFC, your relative or anyone. You pay the interest, you would be able to get the interest deducted. Question arises, how much interest you would be able to get the deduction? You will be able to get the deduction of interest worth actual interest or maximum 20% of gross dividend, whichever is less, would be eligible for deduction. Meaning thereby, if your dividend received from the companies as well as units of mutual fund is 1 lakh and your loan interest comes to 28,000, 20,000 is eligible for deduction. If your dividend comes to 1 lakh and interest comes to 14,000, 14,000 is eligible for the deduction. Maximum 20% of the interest is eligible for the deduction over here, friends. Please be careful. Third one. Yeah. Is it possible, friends, here for my SSC to argue that it is my main business? Someone asked for that intraday. Now, along with intraday, he also invests in short term, but shows this as business and profession only, and shows the shares as stock in trade. On stock in trade, shares assume sometimes you kept the shares on record date on which you receive the dividend. You are doing this intraday on loan and you pay the interest. Now you have the dividend income from which you want to get the interest deductible. Can you say that this restriction of 20% is given under section 57 and not 36(1)(3), which is deduction of interest in the topic business and profession, and hence I would be able to get full deduction under section 36(1)(3) because I am offering my dividend for taxability under the head business and profession. Answer is no. Reason being, friends, dividend, whether on the shares or units of mutual fund held by you as investment, or whether the shares or units of mutual funds are held by you as the stock in trade, the dividend has to be chargeable under the head income from other source only. And if it is chargeable under the head other source, you don't have right to go to computation mechanism given under section 36(1)(3). You have to be in the computation mechanism given under section 57. Maximum 20% interest is eligible for deduction. Dividend from domestic companies subjected to TDS, if to individual, if it exceeds 5,000, the rate of TDS is 10%. Sorry. But mutual fund units, the TDS is to be deducted if aggregate dividend exceeds 5,000 at the rate of 10%. 194K, the wording of 194K is income from mutual fund, units of mutual fund. Luckily, government came out with clarification and thereafter inserted in the act itself that income from units of mutual fund doesn't include capital gain, it includes only the dividend income. So dividend on mutual fund would be subjected to TDS under 194K. 1034, 1035, 115O, 115 BBDA are the sections which are abolished, not applicable for 2021 financial year or 21-22 financial year. 22-23, God knows. Now, let us divide for the purpose of understanding the dividend. My portion, I'm dividing into two for the purpose of understanding various dividends. The first one is 222E dividend, that is loan advances. And second is final dividend, interim dividend, or other deemed dividend. Other deemed dividend will include anything distributed in kind to the shareholder which is prohibited under the Companies Act, or bonus shares given to preference shareholder which is also prohibited under the Companies Act. But that is there in the my statute book. We have to check out. If we talk about other dividend than 222E, I am clear that it is applicable to all the company, public, all the companies, public, private, closely held, widely held, or whatnot. Business, any business company has got, it would be applicable. While 222E will be applicable only when it is closely held company. Second, 222E is applicable if it is given to shareholder having substantial interest in the company. Substantial interest means 10% or more voting power. While other dividend would be applicable when it is given to any shareholder, whether they've got 2%, 5%, or 20%, or 14%, or 24%, it would be applicable. Mind well, members and my seniors and my friends, that in 222E, substantial interest is defined as not 20% or more, substantial interest is defined as 10% or more voting power in the company from which, closely held company from which you get this particular dividend or you get this particular loan. For 222E, accumulated profit would be total accumulated profit, while for all others, percentage of accumulated profit. If I clarify, one company has accumulated profit. Accumulated profit, I'm coming to the discussion what would be accumulated profit. It is commercial profit. It is reason. Assume company has accumulated profit worth 1 lakh. I am shareholder holding 12% shares. Company gave me the asset worth 15,000 rupees. That is prohibited under the Companies Act. But if I am given asset worth 15,000 rupees by the company, then 15,000 will be market value of asset given to me, or out of 1 lakh, my share of accumulated profit is 12,000. So 12,000 lesser of the two will be 222A deemed dividend to me. That would be 12,000 will be taxable to me under the head other source. But in place of this, I'm holding 12% shares in the company having accumulated profit of 1 lakh, I'm given the loan of 15,000. Then for calculating 222E deemed dividend, one has to take loan amount 15,000, or not percentage of accumulated profit, but total accumulated profit, that is 1 lakh. And lesser of the two, 15,000, will be my 222E. There is a fundamental difference. In other sections, it is percentage. In 222E is total accumulated profit. And accumulated profit also has got difference. In others, it would be including capitalized profit, meaning thereby bonus if issued in past, it would be part and parcel of accumulated profit. While in deemed dividend, 222E, it is other than capitalized profit. And both now, as of today, taxable in the hands of the shareholders. Now the peculiar issues would be related to 222E. Friends, 222 is applicable to closely held company. Members, kindly pardon, I'm having my tea along with, I hope it would be okay. I missed that during the break session, it was not ready. So I'll continue along with tea. Company closely held is covered for 222E, subject to company doesn't have the business of money lending. If NBFC is giving the loan to some director or some substantial interest holder, then 222E is not applicable. Point is, if say for example, my company has primary object of the production of MOI, and my company has incidental object of finance. Primary object, production of movie, incidental object is financing for the movie, and the loan is given to the shareholder having substantial interest, whether 222 is applicable. Answer given by Honorable Mumbai ITAT in the case of Jamu Sugard, a famous movie producer and financer, is no. You will say that then each and every company will have the incidental object of money lending. Sir, MCA will never give you the registration if you are keeping the incidental or any sort of object to be money lending. So this is now only of an academic importance, unless otherwise you manipulate with your object and try to convince MCA and try to convince Income Tax Department. But incidental object would also do under my act. Assume loan is taken by me in the morning and repaid in the evening. I am substantial interest holder in the company. Closely held company, whether 222 is applicable? Yes. In our Ahmedabad, in our Gujarat, it happens number of times. Private limited company and its director are having the bank account in the same bank, same branch. Director has issued the check and he doesn't have the fund. Private limited company transfers the fund today morning, takes back tomorrow evening or today evening. I'm afraid 222 will be applicable, a very old judgment of Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Tarulata Syam saying against the SSA. Same way, for a very short duration bona fide loan given, 222E will be applicable. See, government is not interested in listening anything. But you, in place of money, you are given loan in kind, 222E will be definitely applicable there. Assume the loan is given to employee and then employee gave the money to the shareholder having substantial interest, and government could prove the nexus. It's difficult for government to prove the nexus, but if government is able to prove the nexus, Honorable Supreme Court says 222E will be applicable. Genuine business transaction advances, 222 is not applicable. I clarify. Assume company is buying raw material from the shareholder having substantial interest, and company is giving advice to the shareholder having substantial interest for supplying the raw material. Don't worry, 222 is not applicable. Company is selling goods to the shareholder on credit, at a normal credit period, 222 is not applicable. It is Karnataka High Court in the case of Bagmane Construction Private Limited 2015. Friends, this particular topic 222, it does not cover merely the loan. It covers even if you have made any personal payment on behalf of the shareholder, debiting shareholder account, then also 222 is applicable. Company paid the life insurance premium of the shareholder. Company doesn't want to bear the expenditure because company comes to know that the shareholder's insurance premium we have paid, we are not going to get the deduction. Director, it's a different story. But shareholder, we cannot get the deduction. Company debited the same to shareholder account, 222E will be applicable. It's a personal expenditure on behalf of the shareholder paid by the company. And I'm afraid shareholder won't be able to even enjoy ATC, because for enjoying ATC, he himself has to make the payment of the premium. So he's double cost. Friends, now where it happened. Assume that I have taken the loan from the company as on today. From a closely held company, I have 14% shareholding today. I've taken the loan. 222A will be applicable. Now tomorrow, that is on 11th of September, I have transferred 5% of my shares to someone else. So now I'm holding 9%. And on 15th September 2021, I take another loan. On 15th September 2021, I am having only 9%. With the 222, it will be applicable or not? Answer is no. Be very careful. In almost all the part of the act, the law, Income Tax Act, you have to look at the substantial interest at any time during the previous year. While this is the section wherein you have to look at the substantial interest as on the date of loan. I know that you are going to argue that it's a fantastic planning that on the day when you want to take the loan, keep your shareholding down. Thereafter, again, buy back the shares. Sir, this is closely held company, whether the transfers are so much simple, so much free. Answer, in my opinion, is no. You will say, no, sir, it is simple. We work on the companies. We do this. Agreed. Even if you make it, if government involves, income tax department involves itself into the depth and find this to be a bogus transaction, malafide device to evade 222E, avoid 222E, then I afraid they'll consider the same to be taxable in your hand. But if it is genuine case of on the date of loan, not 10% or more, and after that it is more or before that it was more, 222 is not happening. CBDT came out with a circular number 19/2017 on 12 June 2017, which says trade advances are not covered by 222E. Recently, this last issue happened in one of my clients' case, or the appeal is being there with me from some other CA. But what happened was, a small case, it was 8 lakh rupees added by AO as 222E in the case of the shareholder having substantial interest. There were no good argument made by that chartered accountant before the learned AO. It was physical assessment at that time and the addition was made. Now we have filed the appeal. One hearing has come online now. The fact of the case was the shareholder, substantial interest shareholder, was having credit balance for 2,30,000. And during the year, he was given 8 lakh. So that 230, which was credit balance, now repaid back can never be considered as 222E. So that would first go out of 8 lakh, 230 will go out. Now the question would be only of 5,70,000. Now 230, I'm confident I'm going to win. We have Kolkata High Court. Another 570, I'm making a vague argument on the basis of the facts which are manipulated, that director, he is also director in the company, and his director remuneration offered in the return is rupees 6 lakhs. So 570 was the advance remuneration which is given to him, and hence 222 is not applicable. I made the argument. Luckily, I'm not paid any remuneration. It was only on due basis. I wanted to inflate my return. Director wanted to inflate the return, and he has shown, and company wanted to get the expenditure deducted. So company has not paid anything to the director. Company can say that this is payment. It is wrongfully debited to the loan account certified by the statutory auditor. That is what all I'm saying. I was expecting the question from the CIT appeal side on statutory auditor, why kept in the loan account and this, that. A very nice question is asked by, I took the reference of this circular also. Very nice question is raised by CIT appeal, that your assessee was given loan in the month of May. Is it a tradition of the company to pay the advance remuneration to everyone in the month of May for the whole year? Kindly give the payment of salary detail or remuneration detail to other employee and other director to justify the remuneration in advance, and I don't have any answer. But credit to debit, they have accepted for other. I'm still fighting. I'd never lose the hopes. I fight the case. Even if I know that I have got a wooden sword, I go on fighting the case till the time I either win or lose. Friends, same way. A moment, please. Shareholder, say for example, Y Limited has invested in X Limited 10% or more. Now from X Limited, Y Limited is getting share application money for which assume shares are allotted or maybe pending allotment. Whether 222 is applicable? Answer is no. It's a genuine transaction of issue of share capital. If it is, then 222 is not applicable. If it is pending allotment, no 222. If it is allotted, then there is no problem at all. Now, if it is pending, I go beyond these two judgments of Honorable Delhi High Court. If it is, say, for example, application money received and returned, then you have to justify to the satisfaction of AO that what is the reason of refund of application money. You have to justify to the learned AO that you have refunded to other applicant also and the reasons for the same. Then only it would be a bona fide case and you can take the shelter of this Delhi High Court judgment, otherwise not. Friends, a funny thing happened in the case of Sunil Chopra, Honorable Delhi High Court. What happened was, Sunil Chopra, a director of the company having substantial interest, got the advance from the company against the sale of the property. When the case came up, department asked that, oh, it was advance for the sale of the property. Who is having the possession and the ownership? Sunil Chopra was having the ownership. Sunil Chopra was having the possession. The argument forwarded by Sunil Chopra was that it was written that we will give the possession after 5 years of the receipt of advance. Department said it is not customary or tradition to give the possession after 5 years of receiving the advance. And if you have received the advance from the company in which you are having substantial interest, Mr. Sunil Chopra, 222E will be applicable. Along with this, I have not written two judgments over here, but PK Abu Bakr, wherein almost the facts were similar. You've seen number of people making planning that they buy the property in the name of the director. Director give it on rent to the company. Company pays the rent. Company gets the deduction of rent and director rent will be taxable with 30% standard deduction in the topic house property. Now here, in the case of PK Abu Bakr, Honorable Chennai High Court, what happened was that director wanted to construct the building. Director was not having money. So company transferred the money to the director account or substantial shareholder account. Director was making under construction building with the money given by the company. Director constructed the building. Constructed the building. Meanwhile, the notice of scrutiny came in the hands of director saying that it is 222E taxable to you. Director said, oh, it's not taxable to me. This is the building. Now, a moment, please. All from our branch, so director said that, sir, this is a building I'm constructing in my name, but it is to be let out to the company. So what company is doing is company is giving me advance rent. Department asked, what would be your monthly rent? Assume the director said 50,000. What is the amount you have received till now from the company? Director said, I have received 30 lakh, meaning thereby it is 5 year rent in advance. Where is the customary tradition to get 5 year rent in advance or deposit? It is not 222E would be applicable. PK Abu Bakr, it was added. But in the case of our film star Sunil Shetty, Honorable Delhi ITAT, Sunil Shetty was given some money for buying the property in the name of the company as per the board resolution. Sunil Shetty was traveling outside the city where company wanted to buy the property. Sunil Shetty's account was been credited, the company transferred the fund to Citi's account. Now it is not possible due to Binami Act, but it was transferred to Citi's account at the time. And Mr. Sudhir Shetty went out station, could not purchase the property in the name of the company, returned the money. Department applied 222E, Mr. Shetty could justify with the facts and board resolution of the company and all other relevant facts. 222E is not applicable. Same would happen when your director is traveling. Petty case is given to director for company's expenditure. Director could not expend. He returned the money back. 222E is not applicable. Assume I have substantial interest in Axe Limited and I am given the loan by the subsidiary company of Axe Limited. Whether 222E will be applicable? Answer is no. I should be given the loan only from that company in which I have substantial interest. If I am given the loan from some other company, 222E is not applicable. Another important issue I wanted to check here is whether this substantial interest is to be seen along with the relative. Like assume I have 8% mine in X Limited and 4% my wife is holding in X Limited. Whether we jointly are said to be having substantial interest? Answer is no. In 222E, on the date of loan, individual substantial interest is relevant and not joint substantial interest. Please be careful. So these were few issues I wanted to touch upon on 222E. This is the taxability of gift chart, which is adopted by me from ICAI publication only. And all credit to Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. They are coming out with finest material, I would say. There is a booklet of various charts issued by ICAI. I exactly don't know the exact name and whether it is issued by Delhi or I don't know, but I have adopted it from that only. That if you receive the gift from relative, WRC of ICI, it has been issued. If you receive the gift from this relative, the taxability of gift, even if above 50,000, would not apply. And almost all the relatives are covered, bearing few exceptions, I would be discussing. For me, my spouse, my children, brother, sister, parents, brother, sister of spouse, brother, sister of parents, lineally ascendant, descendant of myself or spouse of any person mentioned above are my relative. If we look at the definition given under 56(7) of the Income Tax Act. Now, if I go to important issues related to taxability of the gift, one very important point you have to notice that gift in cash or gift in kind is taxable. For kind, the valuation question will come into play. Movable, fair market value. Immovable, it is stamp duty valuation, which would be coming into play. Now, the point to be noted is that if I gift to the chairman, sir, of Ernakulam branch, say one personal movable asset of mine. Say, for example, I give my personal motor car to the chairman, sir. We are not relative. Whether it would be taxable in the hands of chairman, sir, answer is no. Why no? Because for taxability of the movable or immovable assets, taxability of gift in kind, the asset gifted or the asset received in gift must be capped. Capital asset defined under section 2 bracket 40. Personal movable assets are not capital asset, so the taxability will not arise. Same way, if Mr. X gifts to Mr. Y rural agricultural land, X and Y are not relative. If rural agricultural land is gifted, taxability of gift will not arise. Why? Because it is also not a capital asset. This is a very important part. Try to be careful. Second, friends, the point is, I receive the gift from my uncle. My uncle falls under the definition for individual. My uncle falls under the definition of brother, sister of parents, father, mother, sister and spouse, brother and spouse. So it falls over here, father's brother and spouse. It falls under this category. So it won't be taxed. If I receive the gift from my uncle, from my father's brother, not taxable to me, relative. But if my uncle gets the gift from me, I am nowhere in the list of relative. Nephew or niece giving gift to uncle, it would be taxable in the hands of uncle. Friends, be careful. Everyone is not your relative under 56-7 for the taxability under 56-10. Cousin, brother, sister, I am afraid it would be taxable because your real brother, sister are covered, not cousin, brother, sister. But adopted child, stepchild, adopted brother, stepbrother are part and parcel of your relative and will not be taxable. Now something unique. For HUF in the Act, the definition of relative covers member. So if I give to my HUF for 70,000 rupees, it won't be taxable to HUF. 64-2 clubbing will be applicable, we will be discussing. But if my HUF gives to me, clubbing won't be applicable, but that gift received by member from the HUF will be taxable. Reason being, for member, the definition of relative does not anywhere covers HUF. We have our own Rajkot ITAD judgment which says that member receiving gift from HUF will also be relative because you have to apply the definition of relative very broadly. Sir, if you are applying the definition of relative very broadly, what is the problem in nephew or niece, or what is the problem in cousin, brother or sister? You cannot apply the definition so broadly to read what is not given in the law. And hence, I would disagree, HUF to member will be taxable in the hands of. Third issue I wish to pick up in other sources, the planning which are made by many companies. Assume I have a client which is having a newspaper in Ahmedabad. He's having a weekly newspaper in Ahmedabad. And father and son have started the same. It's a private limited company. Their share capital is 50,000 each. 5,000 shares of 10 rupee, 5,000 shares of 10 rupee, total 10,000 shares, father and son both. Now they want investors. Investor is ready to invest in the company 10 lakh rupees. If investor invests 10 lakh rupees, father son has invested 1 lakh, 10,000 shares. Investor wants to invest 10 lakh rupees. Investor wants to invest participating in equity. Now, we are very clear, father and son, my clients are very clear that they want to part with only 25% equity. Now, if we part with 25% equity, assume we increase our authorized capital and out of this 10,000 which we are holding, we keep this as 75%. And if you say, for example, 3,330 shares to that outside, for 10 lakh, sorry, then each 10 rupee share is issued at 300 rupee, which is too high. Now the point is, can we issue? Answer is, if it is private limited company, private limited company issue their share at a price higher than the fair market value, then in the hands of private limited company, this amount received over and above the fair market value will be taxable to private limited company as gift under the head income from other sources. It would be taxable under the head income from other source to the private limited company. Very important conditions to be kept in mind is that sales equity or preference are issued by the closely held company. shares are issued to resident, get the private equity, get the investor from outside India, non-resident you can get, venture capital I'm coming, you can get in startup I'm coming. But if it is issued to resident, then only this rule will be coming into play. Third, shares are issued at premium and your issue price is more than fair market value. If all the conditions are fulfilled, then the difference between fair market value and the issue price would be gift in the hands of the company. Fair market value is a difficult task. The fair market value of the shares is to be determined on the basis of the net asset method, including the intangible asset market value to be taken, and it should be justified before the AO. Now, my newspaper is very new. We don't have that much assets. I have got only one license. That license is issued by the central government with a very good name, Gujarat Mail. So that has got some value, but I have to justify. I cannot justify a 300 rupee, 290 rupee premium because my company as of today is a loss-making company. I can take a filter to any other method prescribed by IT department. Another method is prescribed by IT department under Rule 11 UA, which is, you are aware, discounted cash flow method. Friends, your discounted cash flow has to be certified by merchant banker, and we have a good judgment of Jaipur IT80, which may be very helpful to you. If fair market value is decided on the basis of Rule 11 UA, as per DCF, as per the guideline issued by ICAI, the AO is not justified in rejecting the same. If I have made some vague estimates of my profit, then AO can definitely challenge. But normal methodology, I am afraid, AO cannot reject. Three important issues I have, or three plannings I have to avoid 56 to 70. As I have said, one, take the investment from the non, first of all, take the investment at market value, there won't be any problem in the hands of private limited company, that is one. Second, if you don't want to get the investment at market value, because see, generally the point in private limited is you want to part with less number of shares, less number of percentage equity to the outsider, getting more money. So you have to issue it at premium only. If you are issuing it to the non-resident, then there is no problem. The point to be taken care of is that assume investor has made investment in the month of May. Hardly, say on 2nd May, hardly 32 days have passed in the financial year. 2nd May 2021, let's assume. Now the point is, the investor was non-resident in the earlier year, that is 2021. Can I take the shelter that he was non-resident in the earlier year and I took the investment, and in the current year for 32 days he was in India, but he promised me that he will leave India and he will become non-resident, and that's the reason I have taken the investment. Unfortunately, he has become resident in the current year. So what should I do as a company? I will not pay the tax. Whether the shares are issued to non-resident means non-resident in the earlier year or non-resident in the current year. In my humble opinion, it is non-resident in the current year, and my argument that he promised me and so on and so forth is not tenable in the eyes of law, as bare verbatim are very clear. Number two, if you receive the money from venture capital undertaking or venture capital received by, sorry, venture capital undertaking from VC, venture capital company or venture capital fund, then this section is not applicable. And third, if yours is eligible startup company which has got the registration with DPIIT as per the notification dated 19 February 2019, then, and if they give the declaration in form 2 specifying that they will not invest in certain asset and they should not have invested in certain assets within 7 years of the end of the financial year from this money, then also 56 to 7B is not applicable. This 7 and B both are small. I was having some issue in making it small, so not put. But friends, to this 56 to 7B will not be applicable. So get yourself registered in startup if possible, and then you can issue the shares at any price This is to encourage the startup. This exemption is provided. Startups are having many exemptions. ESOP, we have seen ATIAC, all of us are aware. And this third, sales issued at a higher price. And now I commonly go to certain intricacies related to clubbing. Clubbing, I have picked up those issues which I find practically relevant. If I transfer to anyone which is revocable, I put my right reserve, which would generally not happen, but I have, say, for example, given some debentures to an outsider saying that I have got right to get it back whenever I want, then it is a revocable transfer. It would be clubbed with my income. Assume I have transferred 1 lakh rupee debenture saying that out of this 60,000 revocable and 40,000 irrevocable, what would be clubbed? Interest on whole amount will be clubbed. We have Honorable Kolkata ITAT in the case of Hrishikesh Ganguly, which says that whether the transfer is revocable partly or wholly, the whole income will be clubbed, because verbatim of the legislature are, if the transferor has made a transfer which is revocable partly or wholly, comma karke likha hai, the income on gifted asset is clubbed. Income on gifted asset is clubbed. So it would be fully clubbed. Against that, I gift 1 lakh rupee debenture to my wife. My wife gives 40,000 rupees to me. That means she gives me part consideration. What would be clubbed? Here only the amount to the extent of inadequate consideration will be clubbed. So first one was section 61, and second one is, all of us are aware, 64.14, wherein the verbatim of the legislature are different. In 64.14, only to the extent of inadequate consideration, it will be clubbed. Someone gifted to fiancé or girlfriend before the marriage, after the engagement, assume. And after the marriage, he wedded to the same girl who becomes his wife. After the marriage, whether the clubbing will be attracted, I make an assumption that you are aware that an individual gifting to spouse attracts the clubbing. On the gifted amount, if spouse receives the income, that income attracts the clubbing, is the section 64.14 is crystal clear in your mind. With that, I go to these intricacies. If the gift is made to girlfriend or fiancé before marriage, after the marriage, income earned by the wife, on the amount received before marriage, will it attract the clubbing? Answer given is no. Why answer given is no? Because John Philip Plaskett Thoms, Honorable Supreme Court, says that relationship must subsist both on the date of gift as well as on the date of income. Same way, husband gifted to wife, it would attract clubbing till the time they are husband and wife. But if they are divorced, after the divorce, it won't attract the clubbing. Minor son's income, minor child's income would be clubbed. If minor is earning from skill, it will not be clubbed. If minor is not earning from skill and minor is ATU, suffering from mental physical disability, then also it will not be clubbed. But minor is perfectly all right and earned other than skill, it will be clubbed. The question arises whether minor includes stepchild, adopted child, yes. But whether minor includes illegal child, answer is no. In spouse also, whether illegal wife is covered, answer is no. It would be legally wedded wife and child, which may be from legally wedded wife or adopted or stepchild, are covered in the portion section 62-64. Assume parents are divorced. Then to whom the income of the minor would be clubbed if it is other than skin? Then it would be clubbed with the parent who is maintaining the minor. What must have given the order who will maintain the minor? To that parent it would be clubbed. Now assume that Mr. X, Mrs. X has a minor son, X. Mr. X, Mrs. X are divorced. Custody of child is given to Mrs. X. Income will be clubbed with Mrs. X. Now Mrs. X married Mr. Y. Son X would become stepchild of Mr. Y. After the remarriage of Mrs. X, the income earned by minor child, son X, would be clubbed with new father, Mr. Y, or mother, Mrs. X, whoever has got higher income. So, adopted child, stepchild, I'm trying to clarify. Assume either of the two parents is dead. It would be clubbed with the parent who is alive. Both the parents are not. Then minor's income will not be clubbed with the guardian. It would be taxed to minor only. Minor is on from acting, number of child artists in the movie or serials are working. Minor on from singing or dancing or acting, income earned by minor will be taxed to minor. Now this income earned from singing, dancing or acting is invested by minor on which interest is earned. Whether that interest will be clubbed, yes. Because the verbatim of Section 64(1)(a) says that any income earned by minor from other than skill will be clubbed. Other than skill will be clubbed. Now, singing income is skilled, it would not be clubbed. But if singing income is invested somewhere on which interest is received, interest earned is without skill, it will attract the clubbing. Now, two, three issues are very relevant. And I know that it has been marathon 2.5 hours, but now last 5 minutes from my side. And now two, three issues are very relevant. I or husband gifted long-term capital asset to wife, long-term land to wife, which is sold by wife, and wife earned long-term capital gain of 60 lakhs. I gifted to my wife long-term land, my wife sold, capital gain is 60 lakh. It is going to be clubbed with me only. My wife has invested 22 lakh in 54 EC bonds. Whether she will be able to enjoy exemption? Yes. Whether the net income after exemption is clubbed with? Yes. So 60 lakh less 22 lakh, 28 lakh will be, 38 lakh will be clubbed with. I have also invested 25 lakh. Can I enjoy exemption of that 25 lakh under 54EC? Aggregate doesn't exceed 50 lakh. Mind well, that limit prescribed under 54EC. Can I also enjoy exemption of 25 lakh on the investment made by me? Answer is no. Remember, friends and seniors, my members. Point is, the income is computed applying the rules of head in the hands of recipient, that is wife. Section 45 to 55A of the topic capital gain is to be applied in the hands of wife. Wife will be able to enjoy 54EC. Net income under that capital gain is computed. Now that net income will jump to 64(1)(4) and come in my hand, husband's hand. Now from 64(1)(4), I cannot go backward to 54EC to claim the exemption. I have to go forward only. I repeat, I have to go forward only. So my investment will not qualify for 54EC. On the long-term capital gain earned by my wife, in spite that long-term capital gain is clubbed with me. Something very important. If I extend this particular issue, income 38 lakh is clubbed with me. I have to forget my 54EC, unfortunately. My wife has carried forward long-term capital loss worth 7 lakh. And I have carried forward long-term capital loss worth 5 lakh. Question is, can I set off the loss of my wife? Answer is no. I can set off the carry forward loss of mine because carry forward is coming under section 7280. So in 64(1)(4), the income was in the hands of wife. See friends, it was here, wife's hand. Computation is made in the wife's hand. Then it has gone to husband's hand. Now after it has gone to husband's hand under 64(1)(4), all sections which are coming after 64(1)(4) would be that of husband only, and set off would be only husband's long-term capital loss. You cannot go from 45 to 55 a computation in the hands of wife, then set off 70, 80 in the hands of wife, come back to 64(1)(4). No, you cannot go in zigzag manner. You have to go sequentially only. So 54 EC of wife, set off of husband. Something important. Question arises. I gifted to my wife started the business, earned the income from the business. That business is eligible under section 80I. Yeah, I gifted to my wife made it in the saving account, my wife earned saving interest, which is clubbed with me. Whether I would be able to get 80IB or 80TTA? Yes, if income is in the nature of eligible for deduction, this deduction is available. Minor earning saving interest clubbed with parents, 6,000 rupees is the interest from this 1,500 rupee 1032 exemption available to minor, 4,500 is clubbed, 80 TTA worth 4,500 along with parents interest in aggregate 10,000 rupee. 64(1)(2), my mistake, talks about if any spouse has substantial interest in the concern from which other spouse is paid remuneration, without skill, then that remuneration will be clogged. Question arises. Your substantial interest is to be seen on the date of giving the remuneration, like 222E? No. Unlike 222E, here it should be on any day. Assume I have substantial interest on 1st May. And substantial year interest here means 20% or more. I have substantial interest till 1st May. After that, I have sold the shares. I don't have substantial interest. Remuneration is paid to my spouse in the month of June. This 6412 clubbing will be a trap. And here, substantial interest is 20 or more on any day, and not individually, but jointly. So this is totally opposite to 222E. Indirect transfer, whether it will be clubbed, like I give to some friend of mine and my friend gives to my wife, nexus is proved, it will attract clubbing. Cross transfer, it will be clubbed. I give to my brother's wife and my brother gives to my wife. It is cross transfer. Yes, Honorable Supreme Court in the court case of Kothari JH says, yes, it would attract clubbing. Assume, friends, I have gifted the land to my wife. My wife sold the land but made the loss. Whether that loss will also be clubbed with me? Yes. Question arises, under which head this loss will be clubbed? Or if there is capital gain, under which head it would be clubbed with me? Whether it would be clubbed under the respective head or it would be clubbed under the head income from other source? Answer is, it would be clubbed under the respective head to me. If my wife has earned salary, she'll get standard deduction 50,000, net salary will be clubbed with me under the head salary. If my wife has earned house property income, after 30% standard deduction, net house property will be clubbed to me in the head house property. If I have earlier year house property loss carry forward, I can set off against that clubbed income also. So nature of clubbed income will be of the same head as in the hands of the receiver. And where to show in the ITR? Sir, there is no specific column in the ITR for clubbed income. But as I have said in point 13, that it should be shown in the respective head, my minor daughter earning saving interest would be shown by me under the head saving interest in my ITR with 1032 exemption, which is specifically provided in ITR. And to close, I have already said I would be able to get ATTTA also on the same. With this, I close here. I am very, very thankful to Direct Tax Committee of ICI and the Ernakulam branch of the CIRC of ICI, as well as all the participants, seniors, and all members for the patient hearing and the cooperation. I wish that this COVID situation would be over soon and the whole country, with including Kerala and all the parts of the country, rather the world, would be corona free and we'll be able to meet physically very soon. Till then, a very happy and safe life to all of you. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Chairman, can I call you for a small closing remarks, please?
Thank you, Adipa, madam. Once again, very, very good evening to our most respected participants. Indeed, like how Alan said in his introduction, the innings ended up very high, with a very high score. And we should be very thankful to Palak Pavagadadi ji from Ahmedabad. And I should also, in fact, be thankful to chairman of Ahmedabad branch, a very close friend and brother now, Hari Dariwal ji, for having connected me to him when I requested him for a good faculty from the region. He was instant in giving, he had no second thoughts. He was instantly passing Palak ji's number and also told him about us. So once again, wholeheartedly thanking Palak ji for the great session today. You know, the kind of depth that you took the provisions into, the feedback we are all getting through private messages from members is really overwhelming. So thanks to each participants also for the good 5 days that we had for this direct tax refresher course. Like I said, we've got some great programs coming up as well for the month and for the coming months as well, well planned together by the Ernakulam branch, all of us together putting in the best of efforts and to bring in you the best of faculty and best of topics. So thanks to each one of you, and back to you, Deepa madam.
Thank you, Chairman, for your closing remarks. Palak sir, when I was going through your profile to introduce you, you know, like it could be either me or the treasurer, Alan. So when I was going through your biodata, I just saw that you have trained more than 7,500 students. I'm sure most of them would have cleared their DT anyways. The way you have explained it, it was so fantastic with such details. You went into so much of details. Thank you so much for joining Ernakulam Branch this evening and giving us a share of your knowledge. We will definitely invite you in the future. And let's hope that this COVID settles down and we get you in person here in Ernakulam. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Dear participants, thank you once again for continuously motivating Ernakulam Branch to conduct more and more programs of learning. Now, the next program that we have for you is a virtual CPE seminar on audit features and tips for professionals in Tally. This is going to be held on 14th September, which is Tuesday, and it will be from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. where CA Roshni Menon will be handling the session. So we hope to see you all, and we hope that you will continue to enjoy learning with Ernakulam Branch. A word of thank you to all the managing committee members for their cooperation and to the branch staff for their cooperation, without which this program, no program of Ernakulam Branch would be complete. So thank you once again to each and every one of you. We are signing off till Tuesday.